The Iron Hands are not saviors, nor should we be. A man who cannot save himself is weak, and the weak do not deserve to be saved. For such a man, only death is fitting. This we can provide.
The Emperor's angels, despite their many strengths, are not immune to weakness. For even amongst his greatest servants of the legions, thousands would fall to the lure of the ruinous powers and their own decadent delights. Yet some of the first founding legions would seek to banish all failures from their ranks, with one above all going as far as to remove their vulnerabilities and replace them with steel. The 10th Legion of the Adeptus Astartes, the Iron Hands. Though drawn from many disparate lands of Holy Terror, the 10th Legion would draft a large proportion of its members from the region of Old Albia. Influencing the Legion's temperament, the Legion would show fierce pride for its warrior ancestry. Exemplifying a remorseless and highly disciplined form of combat, the 10th Legion would exterminate the Xenos Cypher and Liassic species with enviable coordination and tactical acumen. Incurring few losses despite many environmental hazards, heavy resistance, and deadly foes, the 10th Legion would, regardless of their efficiency, not garner great glories during their initial service to the Imperium. Yet during the invasion of the planet designated 02-34, the 10th Legion would engage in the so-called Battle of Rust. With the Emperor commanding the 10th Legion alongside his own custodians, the 10th Legion would be instrumental in the then largest Imperial mass offensive battle of the era. Losing less than one-fifth of its Astartes, the planet of Rust would be conquered by the 10th Legion. The Legion's use of the Hammer and Storm strategy would be so effective that such a tactic would be employed by the 4th and 13th Legions of Astartes thereafter. Given the title of Stormwalkers, the 10th Legion would soon after hear news of the discovery of their Primarch on the world of Medusa. A discovery which would forever change the Legion. The son of the Emperor would raise himself within the mountain peak of Karashi, amongst the ancient technologies left by a long-dormant species. Defeating a mechanized ancient creature of metal, a Sionov, within the mountain, the fierce young man would melt the creature's hide with Karashi's molten rivers of lava. The molten necrodermis metal would coat the young Primarch's arms, and the peoples of Medusa would know the man as Ferrus Manus, the Iron-Handed. Battling the Medusan clans into submission, Ferrus Manus would demand obedience from his subjugated peoples. Exchanging his own instincts for technological intuition for the secrets of the Iron Fathers and tech priests of Medusa, Manus would craft marvels of technology and weapons of peerless might. Strengthening the Medusan people, their civilization would grow rapidly until the arrival of the Emperor of Mankind. Amongst the first of his sons to be found, Ferrus Manus would pledge his allegiance to his father and be installed as the commander of his Astartes Legion. Ascending from warlord to general of the Imperium, Manus would rename his legion in his image, the Iron Hands. Deconstructing and rebuilding his legion with the care of an artisan watchmaker, Manus would reforge his legion's command structure and ideals. Crafting his Iron Tenth anew and incorporating his Medusan inhabitants into the legion, Manus would purge his legion of virtues and ideals incompatible to his own. Weeding the weak from the strong, not only amongst the populace of Medusa, but his own Astartes, the Iron Hands would be reborn as the single most ruthless and calculating of all the legions. Battle proven during their service to the Great Crusade, the Iron Hands would fight alongside many of their brother legions with distinction. Yet amongst all of them, the most notable bonds of brotherhood would be forged with the 3rd Legion of the Adeptus Astartes, the Emperor's Children. With Primarchs Fulgrim and Ferrus Manus as bonds of brotherhood forged under their shared craftsmanship and alchemical sciences, their legions would follow suit in their shared respect and brotherhood. Both legions perceived as strange outcasts from their brothers within their own rights, the 2 legions would revel in their otherness in comparison to their kin. With the 3rd Legion perceived as peacocks of style over substance warfare, and the 10th observed as dull engines of war, both would complement each other by virtue of their stark contrast. Both legions obsessed with pleasing their primarchs, they would also share their competitive natures as both warriors and artisans. Yet unlike Primarch Fulgrim, Ferrus would mentor his gene sons less as a father figure and more as an overlord. Quick to anger, Ferrus would be intolerant of failure or weakness, quipped by Fulgrim as similar to the ancient monster of terror, the Gorgon. Manus would bear his new title with grim pride. Uncaring for what the wider Imperium would regard him as, Manus would command his legion with rigid and rational discipline, crafting his gene sons into harsh, direct, and indomitable warriors, gaining acclaim and renown throughout the Great Crusade for their deeds as the hammerblow of the Imperium. Though not the greatest in number of the Astartes legions, would nonetheless be regarded as one of the single mightiest armies of the Space Marines. However, their might would soon be sundered, tragically, at the hands of their own most steadfast and beloved allies. During the formation of the coup, Horus would send Fulgrim to convince his most beloved brother to join the usurpers of the throne in their campaign against the Emperor. Refusing outright, Ferrus and his honor guard would be ambushed by the Emperor's children. Beating the Gorgon unconscious, whilst all but his Morlock captain, Gabriel Santor, would be slaughtered by their once allies. With news brought to the Loyalist Legions confirmed by the defected Death Guard captain, Nathaniel Garrow, on Holy Terror, the Emperor would command his remaining loyal sons of the Imperium to crush the Warmaster's rebellion. Consisting of two waves of assault, seven legions of the Adeptus Astartes would crush the traitors. Given command of the assault, Ferrus Manus would lead the Loyalist forces to the Istvaan system to bring justice to the Warmaster. The first assault composed of the Iron Hands, Salamanders, and Raven Guard, their assault would be supported with the second wave consisting of the Iron Warriors, Night Lords, Word Bearers, and Alpha Legion. Assembling at the world of Istvaan 5, the battle would begin. The first wave of Loyalists would engage the smaller in number traitor forces. The battle would be the bloodiest ever seen in the Imperium's history, yet the bloodshed had only just begun. With the arrival of the second wave of legions descending onto Istvaan 5, the battle would become a slaughter, though not in favor of the Loyalists. Turning on their brethren, the four legions and their primarchs would turn on their allies and rain death unto the 10th, 18th, and 19th legions. With the traitors surrounding the Loyalist armies, the Emperor's children would descend unto the Iron Hands. With Primarch Fulgrim and Ferrus Manus engaging in single combat. Yet despite the rage and fury of the 10th Legion's Primarch, Ferrus Manus would be slain by the treacherous Fulgrim. The Iron Hands would be decimated alongside their Loyalist kin, and in one fell swoop, the Iron Hands would incur the single largest catastrophic loss in their history. With over 60,000 Astartes lost in a single day during the battle, and the Loyalist Primarchs lost during the massacre, the now shattered legions would retreat from the battle and escape the planet in fragments of their former strength, with none incurring a higher cost than the Iron Hands. Unable to bring their once tremendous might to face the traitors to the throne, the Iron Hands would conduct hit-and-run guerrilla warfare against key traitor outposts and staging areas. Aiding the much larger Loyalist legions in their struggle against the Warmaster, the Iron Hands would be driven by unbridled anger in their quest to destroy their traitorous kin. Aiding in the scouring of the fleeing traitors, the Iron Hands would demand their pound of flesh as revenge for their fallen brothers and genefather. Yet alike to a shattered blade, the fragments of the Iron Hands would require reforging. And with the defeat of the Warmaster, Horus Lupercal, and the interment of the Emperor upon the Golden Throne, the Iron Hands would rebuild. The leaders of the 10th would form the Iron Council, and resolve that no singular Astartes would command the Legion. As other legions would continue to hound the enemies of the Imperium, the Iron Council would begin the so-called tempering of the chapter, and conclude that their downfall had been a result of their fiery temperament. Determined to embrace cold logic and dispassionate analysis to its extreme, After 86 Medusan day cycles, the Conclave of the Tempering would rule in favor of the Legion's embrace of steel. Blaming humanity's own avarice and jealousy to dragging itself into the mire, the Iron Hands would not repeat the same patterns and mistakes. Embarking on a campaign of bloodletting fueled by the Iron Temp's mechanical logistics, the remnants of the Legion would ally themselves further with the Adeptus Mechanicus by dint of their shared rejection of the weakness of flesh. Now favored by the Adepts of Mars above all Loyalists, the Iron Hands would gain unprecedented knowledge and access to armaments kept secret by the children of the Omnisire. Perceiving their augmentations and cybernetic limbs no longer as an appendage, but rather the true pinnacle of their ascension as warriors. Utilizing the full extent of their genetically enhanced bodies' ability to quickly recover from surgeries, the Iron Hands would en masse replace their limbs and organs. With the most veteran of the Iron Tenth bearing their augmentations as marks of honor and service, the Astartes of the Iron Hands would swiftly embrace the surety of steel. And with Rebute Gilliman's drafting of the Codex Astartes, the Iron Hands would give compliance to the new Imperium's decree. Convening the Iron Council, the remaining leaders of the Legion would divide the remnants of the Iron Tenth into successor chapters. The now chapter's service to the Imperium would be revered for the centuries to follow. Yet during the 35th millennium, a schism would once more fracture the Imperium. The Moray Schism would cause a rift between the factions of the Adeptus Mechanicus. The dogmatism of the cult Mechanicus would undergo scrutiny with the ideals of the Forge World of Moray's more heretical designs. Alluding to the overthrowing of the Tech Priests of Mars, the Moray beliefs would allude to the fusion of the Adeptus Mechanicus and Ecclesiarchy into a unified hierarchical governing and spiritual body. Such utterances would be seen as sedition by the Mechanicus, and so, civil war would be theorized as the only result. The Moray's beliefs would begin to take root within the Iron Hands, causing clans Burgos and clans Raukan to clash for centuries. Facing a civil war within the chapter, the Iron Council would propose a settlement. Those who followed the teachings of Moray would be banished from Medusa, yet a treaty would be signed to prevent war between the Iron Hands and their exiled brethren. As many as one-third of the chapter would depart Medusa and join with other disparate Astartes of their successors. The exiles would during 011.M37 be given special edict to be reformed into the Sons of Medusa chapter of the Adeptus Astartes, despite the protestations of the Mechanicus and other chapters of the Space Marines. Yet the Iron Hands would further splinter due to a disagreement of belief. Facing the demonic entity, the Sapphire King, during 460.M41, the entity forged from the psychic death of the Iron Hands Primarch, Ferrus Manus, would corrupt several Astartes of the Iron Hands. Promising strength and manipulating the chapter's shame and guilt, the Sapphire King would corrupt the Iron Father Christos and the clan companies of Raukan and Sorgul. Confronted by the manifestation of the Sapphire King, the Emperor's children, and hordes of demons of Slaanesh, the Iron Hand Astartes, Cardan Stronos, would identify the flaw in their chapter's doctrine. Realizing that his chapter's rejection of their emotions had fed the whims of the demons of the warp, Stronos would behold the revelation that his chapter must embrace their emotions and harness them with their own iron-forged willpower. Releasing their caged anger, the Iron Hands would deny the demon its hunger for self-pity and be slain by the surviving Iron Hands. Utterly destroying the servants of Chaos, the Iron Hands would nonetheless be scarred by the Sapphire King's deeds. With many Astartes slain and a third of the Iron Council corrupted by the lure of Chaos, the Iron Hands would be forced to once again re-examine their principles and doctrines. Their millennia-old tenets of the Tempering proven to be false, the Iron Council would call an emergency meeting. Stronos would argue that the chapter had been put through a great trial and had proven worthy of conquering their darkest and deepest insecurities, uttering the now immortal words of his chapter.
With steel, we are stronger, but without soul, we are nothing.
With the Eye of Medusa erupting with applause, Cardan Stronos would be elected as the first war leader of the Iron Hands. Re-elected at every subsequent election, Stronos would lead the Iron Tenth into a new era. Iron chaplains and librarians would burgeon with Stronos' influence of the chapter. Logic would be tempered with emotion, and so the chapter would move closer once more to the intended ideals of their Primarch. Yet during the 41st millennium, in the time of humanity's darkest era, the Iron Council would call one last conclave, the Grand Calculation. Deciding the ultimate fate of the chapter, the Iron Council debate and argue where the Iron Tenth shall stand in humanity's defense. Gathering every Iron Hand successor to aid in their defiant final struggle, the Iron Council's debate prolongs, seemingly without end. With the chapter's war efforts commanded by Cardan Stronos, fending off the enemies of his Imperium as the chapter's final calculation is completed. Selecting one or more final foes, the chapter will one day bear its entire combined might to crush its most hated and dangerous enemies. Whether it be the Tyranid Menace, High Fleet Leviathan, the dynasties of the ancient Necrons, or the accursed betrayer of humanity, Abaddon the Despoiler, and his damned Black Legion. Yet all that can be ascertained is that the calculation is arduous and complex, and that the Iron Council shall not relent in their debate until the final calculation has been solved. The 10th Legion had been divided into many logical and highly structured organizations during the Great Crusade. Unlike other Astartes legions, such as the Imperial Fists or the Ultramarines, the Iron Hands would become compartmentalized to prevent its entirety being commanded by overarching command hierarchies or dogmas. Similar to a machine comprised of many interlocking gears and pistons, the Iron Hands' chain of command is beholden only to its immediate superiors. This allows the Iron Hands to specialize in niche operational assignments without being encumbered by bureaucracy or divergent command doctrines. Referred to as orders, these battle groups would function similar to specialized battalions, yet would be deployed only for their specified expertise in battle. Complementing the members within orders, these consignments of battle groups are painstakingly organized to function with machine-like efficiency and deadly application. Given specific instructions per deployment, the orders are expected to achieve their assigned task with no excuses for failure or requirement for reinforcements or support elements. Drawn from the chapter's clans, orders within the 10th would predominantly derive members from in only one clan, yet occasionally mix different clan Astartes into order configurations. Clans being of similar equivalence to legion chapters, each clan would be a reflection of Medusa's ancient feudal society. Each clan possessing a distinctive character, these so-called pocket legions would be commanded by a singular officer known as an Iron Lord. Appointed by Ferrus Manus himself, the Iron Lord's right to command would be unquestionable. With each clan vying for the favor of their Primarch, rivalries and competition would be rife. Though inflexible, the organization of the clans and orders within the Legion would prove to be exceptionally effective. The commanders of the Iron Hands, empowered with absolute authority by their Primarch, they would be obeyed by their junior officers without question or excuse. Each company commanded by a shield centurion, such officers would mete out punishments to ineffective Astartes, which included the right to execute defective battle brothers with no recourse. With such powers also given to each clan's Iron Captains and Iron Lords, the highest judgment would fall to the Gorgon to dispense should it be required. The Legion's discipline without peer, the Iron Tenth would not tolerate failure or weakness of any kind within their ranks, and would reward only strength and accomplishments in battle. With the most strong-willed and competent Astartes rising to ranks of command, the Medusan Society's feudal values would serve as a template for the Legion's ranks of competence to be achieved. The Legion's volatile temperament kept in check by strict values and pragmatic cold calculation, with the inter-Legion clan rivalries being rewarded by their Primarch through deeds accomplished, favoritism would be given to the most successful clans and fuel the less competent clans to strive for redemption. And with the Great Crusade's continuation, the Iron Hands would balance their battlefield losses with a steady stream of new recruits to the Legion. Failed aspirants to join the Legion would be converted into servitors to serve the Iron Tenth. The Legion would often refuse military aid from the Imperial Army, and instead request battle automata from the Mechanicum to fight alongside in battle. Their ties to the Adepts of Mars would be so strong that the Iron Hands would possess many sophisticated weapons and war vehicles. Given access to cybernetic implants only employed by the Mechanicum, the Iron Hands also stocked large proportions of the Mechanicus's deadliest weapons, such as grav weapons, laser destroyers, and conversion beamers. Their collaboration with the Mechanicum, bearing new weapons and armor system breakthroughs that would be disseminated within the wider Imperium, such as the Indomitus pattern Terminator armor suits, Stormbreaker pattern Thunder Hammers, and more potent equipment which the Iron Hands would keep to themselves. With the Legion's elite Gorgon Terminator squads equipped with the unique Gorgon pattern Terminator armor, such suits would be bonded to their wearers. Though extremely painful to graft onto the Astartes within, such armor would be seen as a great honor to bear. Despite its final design never seeing fulfillment, with the untimely death of Ferrus Manus. Relying heavily on their bountiful armored divisions, the Iron Hands would field unique formations of vehicles as distinct individual companies known as the Armored Echelons, ranging from between a dozen to even several hundreds of vehicles. From battle consignments of dozens of Predator tanks and Land Raiders and handfuls of Fellblades, the Iron Hands vehicle battalions would be the largest of any single Astartes Legion. Yet tragically, the vast majority of the Iron Hands armored divisions would be lost during the Istvaan 5 Dropsite Massacre. The Iron Hands would enter the battlefield of Istvaan with an estimated 113,000 Astartes, yet be decimated during the massacre. Losing entire clans, such as the then most favored by their Primarch, the Averni clan, the remnant Iron Fathers of the Legion would convene at their homeworld of Medusa and begin the recruitment and creation of new Astartes. The bountiful gene stores of Medusa, capable of rebuilding the Iron Hands, the clans of the Great Crusade would dwindle and be replaced with newer and more robust clans in the wake of the heresy. With the clans Atraxi, Borga, Felg, Kedoron, and Ungavar fading from the Legion's history, the remnants of the Morrigal clan surviving in numbers capable of one day forming the Iron Hand successor chapters, the Brazen Claws and Red Talons. With the Legion's transition into a Codex Astartes compliant chapter, the Iron Hands would divide its Astartes into 10 new clan companies. Consisting of 100 Astartes per company, alike to their original clan orders, they would function as highly specialized formations. Led by their Iron Captains, each clan formed squads known as Claves. Autonomous and nomadic in nature, each clan maintains a mobile fortress monastery within great land behemoths, which traverse Medusa's dangerous landscape. The foremost elite clan, Averni, bears the burden of failing to protect their Primarch. Fighting alongside Ferrus Manus during Istvaan 5, the Averni clan, whilst the foremost of warriors amongst the Iron Tenth, also instills its members with the bittersweet duty to absolve their shame. Clan Garsak serves as the second company. Led by Iron Father Cardan Stronos during 900.M41, Clan Garsak would defeat the Necron dynasties of the Crimson King alongside their Brazen Claw brethren. Clan Garsak has gained a reputation as exemplary warriors while specializing in battle strategy and war council preparation. Clan Rolkan, the third company, would be commanded by Captain Arvan Ralph. After incurring heavy losses to an Emperor's Children ambush during 929.M41, which resulted in the death of Iron Captain Maklon and their Tech Marine Darmos, the clan would be censured by the Iron Council. Replacing Captain Ralph with Iron Father Christos, the clan would begin to regain its honor until Iron Father Christos' corruption by the Slaaneshi demon known as the Sapphire King. Yet with Captain Ralph's return as commander of the clan, they would recover a portion of its glory in defending Medusa from the onslaught of Abaddon the Despoiler's 13th Black Crusade during 999.M41. Clan Kargul is commanded by the Iron Council's venerable dreadnought, Warleader Banus. A precise and revered clan, they follow the example of Banus and gain much glory for their service. Clan Harmek served as the mechanical savants of the chapter. Drawing their stock from the serfs of the chapter, the members of Clan Harmek ascend to the Relic Guard and preserve the chapter's ancient technologies and war machines. Clan Sorgol are charged with protecting their homeworld's Medusan Reach, the domains of outposts scattered throughout the Medusan subsector. Clan Borgos are the second support company to Clan Sorgol. Marked by past technological heresies, Clan Borgos assists other clan companies by adding their strength to difficult engagements in order to redeem their past transgressions. Clan Morlag specialize in pinpoint strategic deployments and tactical lightning strike assaults. Experts in close support, the Iron Temp's shock troopers revel in causing crippling strikes at vulnerable enemy formations. Clan Vurgan is a well-regarded company led by Iron Captain Agar Verox. Achieving glory during the Third War of Armageddon, the Grail Sword Campaign, and the defense of Medusa during the 13th Black Crusade, Clan Vurgan are characterized by their intense aggression and fury during battle. Implanted with surgical and augmetic implants to temper their rage, the Iron Council undo their emotional outbursts with the surety of steel. And finally, Clan Dorvok consists of the newest recruits of the chapter, purging emotions such as fear, pain, and anger during their service within the clan. The aspirants of the Legion learn the responsibilities and duties required to be a member of the Emperor's most cold and calculating sons. The Iron Hands would arguably suffer more than any Legion during their history. The first Legion to witness the death of their Primarch, the Iron Hands would also be decimated and continually crippled following the Horus Heresy and beyond. Emboldened in their actions to redeem themselves of their failures and to strive to be better than their compatriots within their brethren legions, the Iron Hands would eradicate their weakness with the adoption of the machine. With neophytes of the chapter beginning their journey to replace their biological parts with the ritual severing of their left hands and replacement with a bionic prosthesis. Whether severed by their own remaining hand or plunging their fist into the searing lava flows of Medusa, this act of commitment by every Astartes of the Iron Hands is without question. Self-inflicting scars and burns on their flesh, the Iron Hand skin is left as little more than scar tissue. Each implant and appendage of steel removing a portion of their flesh until they are immune to physical pain. With many of the veterans of the chapter left of little organic matter besides their brains and a selection of organs. Many Iron Hands are driven to one day ascend to become a dreadnought of the chapter, as it is the highest of honors for the Iron Tenth to don the sarcophagus of the war shell of such a machine of war. Augmenting their vertebrae with links of neural relays, the Iron Hands call such strands forge chains. Forged of different materials dependent on the clan company the Astartes is assigned to, the forge chains reinforce their allegiance to their clan, reminding their bearers of the bonds that strengthen their brethren and the might inherent within their inclusion and unity. And for those of the chapter whom prove to be the greatest servants of his Imperium, they shall be given the blessing of iron. Removing the final links of flesh to his body, the blessing of iron brings its bearer closer to the machine god by unshackling them of their personality to better serve the Omnisire. Blending their own beliefs with the doctrines of the Codex Astartes, the Iron Hands comply to its rulings whilst retaining their heritage. Painting their armor with the monochrome and black of its initial founding, they adorn their left pauldron with the chapter's heraldry, their right pauldron bearing their clan. Using their left knee plate to denote their tactical role, such as battle line, close support, fire support, veteran, or command staff. Yet in millennia past, they had previously used their left greave. A select few Iron Fathers still maintain this tradition of heraldry. The right knee plate designates the Astartes squad number in Low Gothic, whilst their rank is denoted by a combination of their helmet styling, knee plates, and pauldron markings. Yet each clan deviates slightly in such ranking structures. For example, Clan Raukan designate their sergeants by brandishing a white skull on the center of their helmets. Their veterans use white painting on the crest of their helmet, and veteran sergeants use a white stripe with a white skull centered upon it. Their lieutenants paint their helmets completely white and add a starburst design to the skull icon, whilst the Iron Captains of the clan bear a white helm with a skull and a golden-winged skull on their right pauldron. Librarians of the chapter bear the blue armor paintings compliant with the Adeptus Astartes, Apothecaries paint their entire right arm, backpack, and shoulder guard white, with an added white stripe on their helmet to identify them as medics of the chapter. Yet unlike the Codex Astartes outlines for tech marines and chaplains, the Iron Hands blur the lines between these distinct ranks with their own unique hierarchical figures, the Iron Fathers. The Iron Fathers acting as both spiritual and technological mentors of the chapter, and as such, often combine the qualities of both to fulfill their role as the leaders of the chapter. For their duty is the greatest among the Iron Tenth, to guide the future of the Sons of Ferrus Manus and Emperor Willing, leading them from their never-ending shame and anger.
Our chapter was driven to the very lip of the precipice. We were forced to stare over its edge into the Stygian depths, into the darkness that awaits us, should we ever fall. Yet fall we did not. What saved us from this terrible plunge, brothers? What has proven our redemption? Not logic, not the desperate, dogmatic purge of all things perceived as weak. It were our souls that saved us, and the strength we hold within ourselves. It was these qualities which make us more than just unthinking steel that pulled us back from the brink.
This has been a tale of the great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Despite their best efforts, the Iron Tenth were unable to completely diminish their inherent weaknesses. Yet not all legions of the Adeptus Astartes chose to transcend their baser instincts and faults. As such, in my next transmission, we shall elucidate the legion comprised of the unabashed murderers, the Night Lords.